the 14th taping of Playboy After Dark, October 23rd, 1968.
About to perform, so come on in and join the fun.
We need for the movie.
I don't think I'm ready. I don't think I'm ready to record yet, fellas. I think I'm gonna let you do it.
Yeah.
Listen, how did you guys all get together? You haven't been together as a group very long now.
9 months, actually.
And did you know one another before that, or?
Yeah, about 2 years altogether, or maybe even longer. Some of us have known each other.
Now, I understand that you all moved into a house together, kind of so you could live together and work together, but it didn't work out. What?
It was haunted.
The house was haunted?
Yeah, sure. Now you really...
And you really believe it was haunted?
I know it was haunted. I saw with my own glasses.
I'm not going to ask you the circumstances under which it became possible for you to see all those strange manifestations, but...
No.
Okay. I tell you what I would like to hear about, though. You had... your first big hit was Hush.
That's right.
And
yeah.
I think that it would really groove the kids if you did that.
Thank you.
girl, she's on my mind. No doubt about it, she looks so fine. She's the best girl that I've ever had. Sometimes she's gonna make me feel so bad. She broke my heart, but I love you the same. Now hush, hush. Thought I heard her calling my name. Now hush, hush. I need her loving and I'm not to blame. Now quicksand, only took one touch of her hand. Oh, my mind, and I'm in so deep that I can't eat y'all, I can't sleep. Na 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 na.
Too many months ago, we were in Hair, and I understand you just finished a new film called Charo, in which you play a B-girl. And in Hair, of course...
What's a B-girl?
Well, a bar girl, I guess. They didn't explain it to you beforehand?
No, I never heard that.
Well, the part that Hair, of course, is about the most spectacular show on Broadway this past season, but it's most noted for the hippie things and the nude sequences. Now, I understand your own background is you're a member of the DAR. Sounds like kind of a...
Not quite, but...
Almost. Well, how does the family feel about this jumping off into such radical aspects of show business?
Well, they were glad I didn't take my clothes off, but...
That was going to be my next question.
I knew that, so I thought I'd get that over with right away.
You were not one of the girls in Hair that took off the clothes.
No, I wasn't. So in that way, they were sort of relieved, I guess. But my mother said that she didn't look at the nude scene. She said she was looking over at the side and up and down and everything. And my father said, well, you know, of course, I've seen lots of nude girls and everything, but no, he didn't say that. But he said he was used to he said he was used to the female nudity, but he was rather surprised at the male nudity. The thing that they didn't like really was, I guess, the treatment of the American flag, but it really wasn't.
Still very exciting theater.
Oh, it's fantastic. I saw it about 3 weeks ago. It's a great play.
Yes.
Everybody go see it.
Yes, I agree. A great show.
Pretty hairy. Say, you know, Lynn does a song that is usually done by a low baritone.
Well, that's what I am.
Or a bass.
Really?
You're a low baritone?
goes.
Good heavens.
And I'm a high soprano.
You're really on tonight, Tom.
Now, she does a marvelous job on this. It is associated with, you know, basses or low baritones. Mm-hmm. Old Man River, and it's really marvelous.
Oh, we'd like you to do it.
Okay. Thank you.
your kind of baritone.
Pleasure, because I'm happy to be here.
What are you doing, Jack?
What does it look like I'm doing? I'm talking to a beautiful young lady.
You've met Nancy.
And we were going to have a little entertainment tonight because, you see, I'm an entertainer. You know, something you don't know about.
It's called
performing. Mm. By the way, you look beautiful. Madame Trousseau called. She wants you back at the museum in an hour.
Right.
And I love it. I love the party. The fact that you overdressed doesn't matter to me because you may sit at the captain's table.
That's
and
what
you
I'm
and Tommy
for.
Will ride the polo ponies on Sunday.
Good.
It'll be terrific. And this one, why don't you puff on the pipe so I know your answers? Good to see you. Good. Give me two if the Apaches attack the wagon train, you know what I mean? But I figured I would do something a little entertaining for the gang because I'm in the spirit of the thing. So
all
why
right.
don't you join
we'll
your
get
friends?
Get out of your way.
And we'll have
and
a wonderful. I'm in the mood for that kind of thing because it's going to be a wonderful. Right. And I love your two nieces. They look terrific. It's wonderful. And after the show, if you're lucky, I'll sell you a map to a schoolyard. Have a wonderful time if you're still with us. And they'll get you before the party's over. But I really am in a good mood tonight because I feel I was going to do something today. I'm on a new TV season. I had the mod shows and everything. And then I was thinking maybe do something, they should have had something really exciting. They could have had like Maya Daly and Beat the Press. That would have been it could have been an exciting kind of show, Maya Daly and Beat the Press. I would like that kind of thing. Because Maya Daly has that kind of thing, they shouldn't pick on him too much. Because I saw them in the convention hall. You notice when they had the, every time they went down them, all you saw was, they should have dubbed in a voice. Like in a foreign movie, they could have dubbed in Edward G. Robinson. Yes, it's my Chicago, I'll do what I want, yes. That's right, I run Chicago, nobody will tell me what to do. Yes, Little Caesar, my town. I won't do too much. I don't want to do too much on Maya Daly because I have relatives still living in Chicago. But I'll tell you the truth. Well, all the politicians, they all have a great attitude. You got to have an attitude. Even in show business, the same thing. That's what makes anything great. It's an attitude. Makes great armies. Here's your stories about the Italian army. Didn't want to fight the Ethiopians. Didn't want to fight the Germans. It had nothing to do with bravery. The attitude is in the margin. The German army, they would walk into Holland. They would come in with that. Yeah, God, we make land, but the paper, they drop the tulips and run. Nobody wants to hear that joke. You work in your garden and have some nut come in. Florence, Florence, paper, you run like a thief, too. In those days, there was no buffering. The French, that's not right. Look at me, just stare if you don't understand. The French had the Maginot Line. She's young, she's still going soupy sails. The French had the Maginot Line. This was a wall that was impregnable. You couldn't play handball against it. And they were up there with guns, berets, dirty pictures of Marlene Dietrich. And he said, we give it to the Nazi when they come. And 3 miles away, they heard that, Florence, Klum, get that glad, Pierre, get the wine, let's get the heck out of here. They didn't want to hear that. The Japanese had 3,000 soldiers ready to do an 8 British soldiers. The British soldiers all had the little Cary Grant walk, you know, in the little red outfits, like they're gonna join Louis Prima's band and sing Bluebirds of Happiness, you know. And the Japanese had guns, grenades, Sony television that turned into lighters. They had everything. They were ready. And they were ready. We give it to the British when they come in. 3 miles away, they heard that British army. And they loved it because it was catchy. And they marched out and they surrendered because they had that beat. That's all it takes. American army, same thing. Over hill, over dale, as we hit that dusty trail. And those kids got that beat. But the Italian army, how could you march to Mire Guare Quante Bello? You can't march in it. That's great for serving minestrone soup. You people are in a good mood tonight. I'm happy about it. You sang beautifully. I loved it. You're dressed wonderful. Your mommy dressed you like that and the whole team good. It's terrific. But you notice someone performers perform, they never, like, feature the people with them. Like, they never do that. You know, they just get up and they say, and we were lucky, and they say, here's my piano player. They always feature the piano player. And Barbi happens to be a nice piano player. I have a gentleman who's been with me for 8 years, and he never gets a chance to be featured. Well, you come out here, Jerry Friedman, my bass player. Nice hand. Will you be here? Boy, and this is a big opportunity for him, right? Because if he does good here, he gets the Lowe's Theater in Guam. And I told him we'd get him an operation, get rid of this, and he'll go to dances. And this is a big, I love the little blue suit. You'll put on a hat and umpire the game. This is a chance for you. Go ahead. You want to do something? This is your big chance. Go ahead. Okay, get ready. This is big. It's a lot of people here. It's great. That's the real big. You see that? Now play something. Go ahead. Do big, baby. Can you just pick it up a little bit? Pick it up a little bit. Just a little peppier. Oh, you're getting them now. I can feel it. Wait a minute, hold it. That's not catchy enough. Let's do something together. This is our big chance. Don't embarrass me in front of them. You ready, sweetheart? Let's show them a professional picture. Let's show them a good professional picture. You ever seen good professional pictures? Watch. Let's give them another one. Okay, here we go. Don't embarrass me. That's another fine one you've gotten me into. Here we go, sweetheart. Let's, come on, don't go crazy. Win it for the old coach in the hospital. Here we go. Jerry, that's terrific. That's terrific. Beautiful, Jerry. You know what we're gonna do now, Jerry? A little nostalgia. Because I always like a little nostalgia. Because we had a lot of rock to show and everybody's moving. But I used to love the old days in show business. I don't go for the My Fair Lady. I used to like Eleanor Powell dancing on a cannon. That was my show business. You realize she was the greatest cannon dancer of our time. That was show business. Jolie, I'm all right, Ruby King. That was show business. Eddie Cantor, I used to love Eddie Cantor because in the middle of a dramatic scene, they'd go into a song for no reason at all. For no reason at all. Eddie Cantor and a kid from Baghdad, he'd say to the Maharaj, Maha, Maha, you mean if I don't find the ruby by 12 o'clock, I'll be dead by dawn? And the Maharaj would say, that's right, Eddie. They always use their real name. If you don't find the ruby by 12 o'clock, you'll be dead by dawn. You mean if I don't find the ruby by 12 o'clock, I'll be dead by dawn? If I don't find the ruby by 12 o'clock, they'll hang me in the morn. Now, if I don't find the ruby, I'm gonna die. If I don't find the ruby, oh me, oh my. If I don't find the ruby by 12 o'clock, I'll be dead by dawn. They're gonna hang me. I'll be dead by dawn.
Gayle and David, I want to congratulate you on the marriage.
Thank you very much.
And with two so active careers, how are you going to work out the problem of forced separations?
Very difficult. We hope to work together, which is the ideal situation. I want to direct very badly, and we have a scheme of things, whether they'll come off or not. All schemes of things fall apart, but we have a scheme of things whereby hopefully we work together and do a picture together, and then I start directing a couple of projects of my own, which will hopefully include Gayle.
Give you more control over it?
Over my career, yes. Mm-hmm. Over Gayle, certainly not.
I understand you've been looking for a kind of a special hideaway.
It's very difficult to know where to live, you know, because Gayle has always lived in America, obviously, and I've always lived in England, and I have associations there, and she has associations here. And the film industry obviously takes us all over the world because the film base is never in England or in Hollywood, where pictures stem from, maybe. It's often on locations anywhere, so where do you live? But we'd like to try and find somewhere which is sort of out of the kind of melee of show business. It's nice to be able to get away once in a while and have that.
Get lost.
Yes,
a little bit.
Absolutely.
I recently saw and very much enjoyed Charge of the Light Brigade. And I think that's about the fifth version of what basically was supposed to be the same story, but this one was a good deal more than just the same old Errol Flynn shoot 'em up.
Well, Errol Flynn was the last version that was made, yes. I think it's, I like the movie tremendously.
I know it's
terrible to say that about your own picture, but I like the movie, I really do. I think Tony Richardson did a marvelous job, and it's not, I mean, you said a very good thing about the fact that it's a bad title, in a way, The Charge of the Light Brigade. Do you think?
Mm-hmm. Mm, I do.
Yes, it sets up a false expectation.
Exactly.
And it's not the same as the original book, is it?
No, the reason why was the original title. But the thing was that everybody expects that if you make a film about The Charge of the Light Brigade, The Charge of the Light Brigade is the star of the film.
So they're waiting for...
You know, they're all waiting for the big charge and the big battle and the whole thing, which this film is not about. It's a series of vignettes about Victorian England, which explains the concepts of how war was controlled, the way people organized their lives, and the way that the balance of power was bought and sold, and that people didn't really know what they was doing. There's a marvelous line, which I think is a great line in the movie, which Lord Raglan says, it's played by John Gielgud. He says, it'll be a sad thing when war is run by people who know too well what they are doing. It smacks of murder. And there is this man who is sending out, you know, 600 people, 780 or whatever it was, to their deaths, but without the concepts, you know. Victorian England as such is very clearly represented in the picture, but I don't think that the average audience understands it, because they don't expect that that's what they're going to see. They expect they're going to see a whole battle situation.
How much do you think that society has really changed and morals have really changed since the Victorian period?
They haven't changed at all. We've acquired a kind of pseudo-sophistication. We've managed to change our masks and, you know, pretend that we've managed to make new masks for ourselves. Now we have the mask of permissiveness. In the old days, we had the mask of tremendous rigidity. But the same bawdy society went on underneath it all, and people were just as responsive or irresponsive, or lack of communication still occurred in Victorian England exactly the same as it does today.
Yet on the other hand, it seems to me that indeed, below the surface, the same things were going on then and now, but that then, in a real sense, there was a mask, a pretense, a hypocrisy about what life was really like, and that though we're a long ways from reaching any kind of satisfactory solution, it does seem to me that in recent years there's been a greater attempt to bring together the gap that exists between reality and the way we pretend things are.
I don't think that's true at all. I think that
that's why I,
you know, I think that the gap exists certainly between reality and fantasy, and in a sense, and I hate to bring this up, but it's what Blow Up was about in many ways. Mm-hmm. You know, we each of us have a reality that we know about ourselves, and we have a fantasy which we project to other people because we have a basic desire, and that is to belong to and be accepted by the group. Irrespective of what that group is, there are always people we respect and want to respect us back. And therefore, we know our faults and failings, and the good thing about modern society is that we're trying to find out a lot more about ourselves. But the basis of society doesn't change. It's only the way one society is able to look at itself which changes.
That's
you
right.
Know, permissive society allows you to look at yourself in a slightly more permissive way, and rigid society says that it's just as permissive and just as promiscuous, and you know, there is still wife swapping. It's just that we don't talk about it as wife swapping. We talk about it as a dignified family relationship. That's what Victorian England is.
Well, you know, it seems that, well, my real point is that the only way that you begin to both see yourself in society as you really are and see society as it really is and begin to solve some of the problems that exist in society is to take that first step, which is to more honestly view the society in which you live. If you wear a continual repressive mask, if you continually push down those parts of society that you want to pretend aren't there, then you'll never solve the problems. The first step towards solving the problems, it seems to me, is to recognize they exist.
This is true, but this doesn't stem actually from personal society. It stems from education.
Well, that's part of it.
The terrifying thing is that we build societies. What I said about belonging to groups is very important, I believe, anyway, rightly or wrongly. Because we build societies as people. We need societies, we need groups, we need to belong to each other very badly. So you walk into the society of the college or the school or the primary school, if you like, and that is a very specific and very separate society. It has its own social structure, it has everything, but it's based on a factual existence of where you are. It's based on competition, it's based on doing better than the next man, it's doing all this. When you come out of the end of that educational system, you are no more fitted for living in the society that you and I know, and all the people sitting in this group know, because it's a completely different set of society rules and regulations. People need to learn what they are very much younger, and not suddenly at 19 or 18 or 16 or 17, have to suddenly find themselves and immediately make an instantaneous decision of what group they want to fall into, or what standards they will make for themselves. They have really to know before that time, and we don't have an educational system in the world that can cater for that. And we need it badly.
I agree with that. I think that the real area in which we might disagree is that it does seem to me that it makes a difference what particular set of rules a society sets up, and that some are better than others, and that rules themselves are not the answer. And what I like about society today is that we seem to be looking for and reevaluating some of the old problems, looking for some new answers.
But you're talking about a very selective society. The discussion that we are having is not really one which caters for the entire American society. We are discussing a minority group, in fact. Mm-hmm. And I don't believe one should think in those terms. I don't believe that you can say Haight-Ashbury is right or wrong. You can only say that young people must be given the opportunities that they need to be themselves, to succeed and exist with other people on an honest and open and communicative level. And you can only do that through education. You can't do it through press releases or through picking individual instances. You must start from the beginning and suddenly say, what can we do about it?
And it seems to me, indeed, in that area, I think we'd agree, because it seems to me that in a less repressive society, you have more opportunity for indeed finding out more about yourself and through better education and more extensive education. But one area I think that we can agree on is maybe a little fine champagne here. I think we'll drink to you and your happiness.
Thank you very much.
I see. Let's get on that.
All you have to do is balance yourself.
Wait a minute. Okay. Actually, is it your turn?
Okay. Yeah.
Let's try here.
Oh, you rehearsed. Oh, you rehearsed. Oh, no, that's not fair. You went in the afternoon. You took this alone. I know that.
That sounds like fun.
This or what? Oh, this.
Have you ever done it with a girl?
Well, this is a new bike. This is what they call a bicycle built for two. Oh, that's good. Just stay there and forget the board. Oh, that's marvelous.
Hey, Brooke.
Okay. Right?
Sure. Try your athletic. I know you used to be a track man.
I don't remember this game, though.
Oh, well, it's very good with skiing.
Ooh, he's going. I told you that. All those Jewish kids got rhythm.
Brenton, I know you used to be a something of a track star, and I saw a little of it there. How do you keep in shape?
I run around the corner every now and then.
Just keep getting on bongo boards, huh? Parties?
Well, not really bongo boards. I usually run a lot around the house, you know, when no one's around, you know.
Well, how about getting you to do something that's a little more in keeping with what you're doing now? Singing a little.
Okay.
night. Wherever they find you'll be back when I look around. Just give me some kind of sign, girl. Oh, my baby, to show me that you're mine, girl. All right. Just give me some kind of sign, girl. Oh, my darling, to show me that you're mine, girl.
Getting the new Playboy plane momentarily, and I've reserved a special seat for you for the maiden voyage. I know how much you enjoy flying.
No, afraid you'll have to count me out here. I don't fly. And it's been
that's why I get to see you in Chicago all the time, because you're always stopping off from train trips.
Well, it's been a few years now. I had a bad experience. I was in Acapulco a couple of years ago, and I was flying at that time, and I couldn't get a flight out, so I had to take one of those non-schedule airlines. A non-schedule airline means they don't know what time they're gonna crash. I wasn't nervous about flying at that time, but there were a couple of things about that plane that upset me. First of all, I like a plane with two wings. One wing is okay if you're going to kid around, but if you're going to get up there and fly, you should have one on each side. Actually, it wasn't a bad flight. We all got in the plane, and the plane taxied out to the end of the runway, and they revved up the motors, you know. And then we had to be towed back to the terminal to refuel. Used up all that gasoline revving up the motors. Finally got the plane off the ground, though. A bunch of the ground crew got together and pushed it off a cliff. And the pilot was very nice-looking pilot, tall, distinguished-looking man, gray, completely gray, except for his hair. That was black. And he was very nice. He spoke to us over the intercom. It wasn't actually an intercom. It was a Dixie cup and a string. And he spoke to us over the Dixie cup, and he said, we'll be cruising at an altitude of 50, 60 feet. He said, we'll be flying nonstop from one end of the airport to the other. We will transfer into buses in order to get over the mountains. They were 80 feet high at that point. I think he was just kidding around about the buses. I think it was kind of a little joke with him to try and take our minds off the fire. The wing was on fire. And I can tell you, everybody in that plane was in pretty much of a panic. You have never seen such a panic in all your life. Fortunately, there was a priest on the plane who had been a fireman. And he got a hold of an axe and he chopped the plane up pretty good. Everybody was nervous-wrecking. You know how when everybody gets nervous, everybody takes out a cigarette? and start smoking. Well, everybody took out a cigarette, but nobody would light up. At least not as long as that priest still had the hacks. But it was a great flight. The pilot kept talking to us over the Dixie cup, and he kept saying things like, "Holy cow, this thing is really flying." Then he'd say, "If you look out of the left side of our plane, you can see our 930 flight on the side of the mountain." So I kind of got a... He kind of cured me, because I feel this way about flying. If the Lord had meant us to fly, he'd have given us wings.
Well,
I heard the pilot say that just before we took off.
I think I'm going to cancel my order for the Playboy plane. Well, one thing I know you do enjoy is golfing. And we've got a great new course up at the Lake Geneva Resort in Wisconsin. Playboy Resort we just opened, and I'd like you to get out there when you can.
That I'll definitely accept. I'll go up on my bicycle. Because I love, I'm a golf nut. I love to play. I played today. I had a great game today. I played a very tough course. First hole, I took, 16, 18 today. That got me off the tee. Then I had 17 lost balls, 3 in the ball washer. You're not quite sure what that is, are you, dear? He'll explain it to you. He thinks it's the same thing she thinks. I finally ended up in the green in 49, but I had a tough break, 3-putted. Ended up the day with a 296, which isn't bad, but I get tired after 4 holes. I had a wonderful experience in the golf course today. I had a hole in nothing. Missed the ball and sank the divot. But I love to play, and it's a great game. But all golf is... I got to tell you, this is a true story, absolutely a true story. I played last year in the Bob Hope Classic, which is held down in Palm Springs, and it's a great tournament. The reason that I love to play in it is because you get to play with all the pros. And last year when I played, you play 4 days, and each day you play a different course and you have a different pro. And last year when I played, the first pro I had was Gabe Brewer, the second Doug Saunders, the third Arnold Palmer, and the fourth Jack Nicklaus. Well, I want to tell you, I was a nervous wreck. On the first tee, they got an announcer with a microphone. He's announcing everybody that steps up. And he says, "Now stepping up to hit the star of Get Smart, Don Adams." And you're up there and you're shaking like a leaf. You can hardly hold the club. And then I heard the guy say aside from the microphone, he said, "Tell that idiot to get back between the markers." And I said to my caddy, "Tell that idiot, this is my second shot." I was really nervous. I was such a wreck. And I was hung over the ball. I couldn't get the club back. And everybody was standing there watching me. I said, "This is terrible. It's embarrassing. I've got to think of something to say. I'll tell a little joke, and that'll make everybody laugh, and that'll break the tension, and I'll be able to hit." So I got up, I stepped back from the ball, and there were people standing right alongside the tee, and I said, "Lady, if I were you, I wouldn't stand right over there where you are." I said, "Because you might get hurt, might be dangerous." And she kind of laughed, and that broke the tension, and I got up and swung and hit her right in the mouth. It was my best shot of the day. I got it. But golfers, golf, true stories about golfers, there's a story about these two golfers on the first tee, and they're getting ready to tee off, and they look down the first tee in the fairway, and they see a guy standing about 200 yards out. So the first guy says, "Go ahead, Harry, hit. You'll never hit him. You can't hit 200 yards. So Harry gets up, hits a line drive, hits the guy right in the head, drops him like an ox in the middle of the fairway. Now the two guys rush down. There's the guy laid out in the middle of the fairway with a golf ball embedded in his skull. He says, "Oh, my God, Harry." He says, "What are you going to do?" He said, "Well, I think I'll take my wedge." He says, "I wouldn't move him if I were you." He said, "Why? Are we playing summer rules?" That's a true story. I just got my wife to take up golf. Big mistake. $400 for clubs, $400 for lessons. Now I get her out in the golf course for the first time last week, and we're on the second hole, and there's a twosome behind us, 2 guys. Now my wife gets up to hit, right? And she says, "I can't hit." I said, "Why not?" She said, "They're looking at me." I said, "They don't care about you. They're playing their own game. Get up and hit." She says, "I can't hit while they're looking." Now I got to turn around and yell at the 2 guys, "Don't look!" Now the 2 guys, and 1 guy said, "What'd he say?" And the guy said, he said, don't look. He said, what are they going to do? So I won't bring my wife up to your golf.
Well, you're both welcome.
I'm sorry you have to leave, but remember, we're going to have another party next week, and if you're able, we hope you'll join us. Till then, good night.
Transportation arrangements provided by Sabena Airlines. Europe begins in Brussels, and Sabena flies here every day.
We hope you enjoyed tonight's show. Next week, the party continues as Hef welcomes comedian Mort Saul, author Gore Vidal, and Three Dog Night. For Playboy After Dark, I'm David Steinberg. Thank you for watching.
Sheena and Toymaster in their endless pursuit of pleasure, and visit a different sort of strip joint for women on the next Playboy 360.
Need a reason to look forward to Mondays? Kick off your week with an exciting lineup of exclusive programming. Playboy Originals. Mondays never look so good.
Ride Playboy's hot new information superhighway, the world of Playboy. We'll beam you behind the scenes of celebrity centerfolds and exciting new programs. Experience virtual sensuality as we turn TV on its axis in engaging interviews with today's movers and shakers. Get interactive with the latest Playmate profiles. Playboy scans the globe for sensational software for your television. Turn on to the world of Playboy.
See. Hear. Feel. Playboy's Hot Rocks, where today's sexiest videos and your senses collide. In our next edition, Hammer and a K7 Sweepstakes. Free your mind and experience the sensation. Playboy's Hot Rocks. It's a physical thing.
A little boy walks in and asks his mommy, "Mommy, how do you make babies?" The mother replies, "Well, daddy puts his penis inside mommy's vagina. That's how you get babies." The little boy said, "Gee, I heard a funny noise coming from your room the other morning, and I looked in and daddy had his penis in your mouth." The mother smiled and said, "That's how you get jewelry."
Yeah!